digital art gem. In 1968, he co-founded Art et Informatique Seminar in Vincennes University in Paris. There he discovered Professor Max Benz's writing on information aesthetics from the early 1960s. These texts radically changed Manfred's thinking about creativity, and within a few years, his art transformed from abstract expressionism to computer-generated algorithmic geometry. Encouraged by the computer music composer Pierre Barbeau, whom he met in 1967, Manfred programmed his first computer drawings in 1969. His first major museum exhibition took place in 1971 at Musée d'Art Moderne de la Ville de Paris. Excuse me, that's wrong. It has since become known historically as the first solo show in a museum of works entirely calculated and drawn by a digital rather than analog computer. During that show, Manfred demonstrated the drawing of his computer-generated imagery using a Benson flatbed plotter for the first time in public. Since 1973, Manfred's pieces have been based on logical structure of cubes and hypercubes, including lines, planes, and relationships among them. The rules of geometry, logic, and mathematics are fundamental to the artist-authored algorithms that generate his artwork. Manfred's work is collected by many renowned museums, just to name a few: the Centre Pompidou in Paris, Joseph Albers Museum Beaux-Arts, Victoria and Albert Museum London, Ludwig Museum Cologne, and the list continues to Amsterdam, Stuttgart, Berlin, Montreal, and New York. Some of these museums have also hosted his solo exhibition and retrospectives of his work. Manfred is a recipient of the Golden Nika from Ars Electronica, the Camille Grazer Prize Zurich, Develop Digital Art Award, the New York Foundation for the Arts Fellowship. Please welcome Manfred Mohr.
I'd like to thank NYIT and you, Patty, to make this evening possible and inviting me to that. I still have to go out of this. History of how I became a digital artist, somebody who programs, writes algorithms. Because when I went to art school in the late 50s, the art of the day was abstract expressionism. And that's a very vital art, which was not very, in this sense, geometric or even intellectual, if you want. But I was very comfortable with this kind of art. And I can say that was my background. But I also have another background, which is music. I was an active jazz musician at that time. So everything is, whatever I do since these days, it always has a reference to music, in the sense that I always compare things, how they would sound. And all my work, I think, is like visual music. So since I have only a limited time and very many photos, I will go very fast through these photos. So what happened in 1960, I was painting things like this. And it was writing and musical expressions, but I started reading books by a German philosopher, Max Benzer, who was also an art critic, and he wrote about, or he argued that art should be rational. And that was exactly the contrary of what I was doing. And it wouldn't get out of my head. What is rationality in art? What is rational? And for years, I tried to work it out. And of course, slowly, like little geometry things came in my paintings, and I thought that that might be rational. Of course, it wasn't rational. And the geometry took over more and more, and still I thought maybe that's rational, but it wasn't rational. It was the construction was rational, but not the content. And because at that time, I sort of cut from black paper forms and moved them around on white canvas and made sort of compositions, but the content wasn't logical. So what should I do? How could I get rational? And that moment, I met a musician in Paris, Mr. Pierre Barbeau, who wrote computer music. That's something at that time. So he gave a public lecture, and during that lecture, I suddenly understood what I have to do. I do not have to create a form and make a composition and this and that. I have to find, before I do make a form, a logic how to create the form and how the form will move around in the space. And that's when I understood I have to write programs. But in 1965, 66, you couldn't learn programming anywhere. There were maybe a handful of books in the world. So I had to start learning programming. Once I achieved that, I still didn't have a computer. At that time, a computer was a room like this here, full of loud machines and air conditioned, and nobody would have this at home. So how do I get to that? So everything was a problem at that time. So one night, again, the lucky strike, I saw in the news, and I lived in Paris at that time, I saw a program how the French meteorology just got a machine, which is called a plotter, which draws the weather map. So I said, Jesus, that's what I need. Mm-hmm. So I ran there, and I asked, of course, it didn't work out so fast, but eventually, to make the short story, that I finally got access to this incredible computer room and the plotter, which was, at that time, I mean, I was the happiest person in the world, because I think no artist in the world had such access to such technology at that time. And so I worked for the next 11 years every night and writing programs and plotting. And of course, the first program I wrote was a random number generator, because at that time, even these machines didn't have that. So the first thing I did was a book with random numbers, and then I constructed a sculpture with random numbers. And I started building up a program, first with horizontal and vertical lines, probabilities of width and so forth. And it got more and more complicated, but always in reference to the music. So I go very fast through these things, because if I start explaining, it will take 2 hours. So I wrote all these programs and algorithms, and at one point I had exactly the same idea again. Of course, it's logical, but there should be something more globally to the whole thing. I should sort of like invent a graphic music instrument, like in music, play a saxophone or whatever. So I thought, and I came to the conclusion that the structure of a cube could be my instrument, because I can play with the lines of the cube, taking them away and so forth. And that turned out very interesting. First, I studied the cube by taking lines away to see what forms they create, and this is what I took away. And then I made a very serious study of taking one line away, two lines away, three lines away, and calculated all the combinatorial possibilities. And I got completely out of my mind what kind of language I suddenly developed here. So I started with these elements to like adding, subtracting, taking logical instructions. Like here is adding up becomes a sign and so forth. So I did all this kind of operations with a cube, and then I looked into statistical distributions, like letting it slowly disappear or concentrate in the center. And I tried a movie at the time, but it was too early. This is a 2-minute movie, and it took me like 6 months to do it. Mm-hmm. So I gave up for that moment. But nowadays, this is a joke because you can do it at home in the laptop. But at that time, it was a real big problem. So the next step was that I cut the cube in the middle. So I had two parts of the cube to draw. So I started disturbing the symmetry. That was one of my first inventions, in the sense that what I want to do is create a sign. I call them etragraphic, that means a graphic being, which has a structure, which was the cube. But I want to make a certain ambiguity, breaking symmetry, and creating like this new signs. So I did, he just showed the same painting. I went on, like I took the cube and from this moment on, everything is sort of based on, when you look at a cube from the front, you only see a square. So this square became sort of my inside operation and my outside operation of the cube. So here I only showed what I see inside of the square, and cut off the rest. I made all sorts of paintings. And then I started cutting the whole thing in four parts. So the symmetry got even more disturbed, and the sign became more and more interesting. So I built the structures, and I wrote a program of a sort of like a biological growth of cubes, which can grow on each other, and I built them as structures. And then I thought, maybe if I would go one dimensions higher, the fourth dimensional structure is nothing else than eight cubes intermingled. So I would have an eightfold vocabulary, and that's what I did. So I looked at the structure of the hypercube. This is a graph, you know. And I mean, you don't see it, but I took the graph apart and showed all these diagonal paths. What a diagonal is, everybody knows, but a diagonal path is a diagonal which, if you take a square, a diagonal, that's like everybody knows. But if you go on the side, each dimension once, that's a diagonal path. So you have a diagonal and a diagonal path in every object. So I built this in wood, which is, these are the diagonal paths. Here I show them how many times they can pass through the same state. And then I cut them in parts, like there are 24 lines, so no, there are eight in each one. So if you add them up, you get the complete graph of the hypercube. So I made paintings out of that. Or I ordered them in a magic square to build this kind of things. And then I left it as a, like I did in the cube before. I turned the cube to zero and looked what I see inside of the square. And I took the whole hypercube apart of the eight cubes and placed them next to each other to study what's in each one. And then, once I understood that, I moved them back together and I created sort of like a shaped canvas, because I cut out everything was outside the square. And I made this kind of paintings, which are, depending on the rotation of the cube, it changes the form and the content and the... And then I had my first retrospective in the Hub Museum in Germany, in Ludwigshafen, where for the first time saw my old work and my new work together, and I really couldn't believe that it would fit together, because they had nothing to do with each other, but it worked out fine. I went even one more dimension higher, where I only show one line from each dimension, and I made this series of a constellation, like here, the 10 drawings is the same drawing every time. It's like in three dimensions, I can look at somebody from the front, from the side, or from the top, and I have three images. I see a face, an ear, and hair. Yeah. And in five dimensions, we have 10 such views. So this is the same constellation seen just from different views. And then I went even one more dimension higher. You see, it's not the mystical part of the dimension I'm interested in, or whatever, the impossibility of understanding the dimensions. It's the structure, which is so interesting and complex, and it gives you more and more possibilities to operate with it. So I studied here in a hypercube, in a six-dimensional hypercube, like I just said, the diagonal paths. That means a diagonal going through each dimension once, and I developed this incredible minimalist drawings, which is just going from one point to another in the structure. Here I cut it out with a laser in metal. It's very big. And again, this is one line seen from here, 15 different points of views. So it's an incredible poetic expression, this thing. Here is in a museum, in a show. And then I tried to put them together as a group of diagonal paths and cut them with a laser out of metal. And I made all sorts of structures. I painted these things on canvas. I did connect all the, every time that the diagonal paths would change the dimension, I connect them with thin lines. And I got to some drawings which are fantastically interesting, but I could not explain to anybody that this is complicated. Even though the content is very complicated, but with five lines, what should I say? So I was sort of standing against the wall. How could I communicate to anybody that this is complicated? So I decided at one point, here I also tried to make the outside lines connecting to the surface. So I built the shape canvas out of it. It built itself, the shape canvas, so to speak. Or I made them bending in metal. And then I thought, okay, if I can't explain the complexity, maybe if I would fill in like random numbers, random colors into these spaces which I create on the left. And then look what it does. And what I did here, I had to understand what I'm doing. So I animated this to unfold it into the sixth dimension. Because I after that, I can't understand it either anymore. But I know what I'm doing. So once I got into these things, I suddenly saw that using random colors, I mean, this is not based on any color theory. The colors should only be there as distinction. And the more different they are, the more they show the spatial relationship. So I did the... So I made paintings. I mean, paintings, I call them paintings, they are digital prints. This, by the way, was shown in your salon one day. And then I also animated this thing too. I made series and the shows. And then I animated this thing. So now, suddenly, if you contemplate on this thing, you feel the complexity of the structure. Even though nobody can understand, including me, but that's not the point, the understanding. It's the it's a visual result I'm playing with, and that shows me that the content is incredibly rich. And these colors, they're randomly chosen, and they disappear and appear and while this whole thing is rotating in six dimensions. Do I go back to this? So I tried it in 11 dimensions. So an 11th dimensional hypercube has like 42,000 cubes or whatever. This is of course a structure which is impossible to even think about. But one can make a choice and use certain cubes from it, and I let the computer paint the surfaces of these cubes I chose. Black and white, I'm gonna leave it white and make it black. And then I rotate them in 11th dimension. And I got these fantastic images. Like you see it. And I built them machines to show. And when you see it turning, it's the same thing that you cannot understand what's going on, but there is an incredible form invention, which is exactly what I was looking for. Always the reference to my music, you know, to the visual music, which is really, it's almost chaotic free jazz what's happening here. So, and then I tried another thing with diagonal paths. I chose a certain amount of diagonal path and let the computer color them, and also let the computer choose the width of the lines. So I created these compositions, I mean, they created themselves. And I animated this thing, but here I built two screens, here I show them flat next to each other. On the right side, the element moves, and every 10 seconds, it changes all the colors and all the lines. And the last image before it changes, it throws on the left side. So when you look at these two screens, you see on the right side the evolution of a sign, but you can't catch it. Whereas on the left side, you get like a slideshow. You can contemplate for a while the sign. And originally, when I showed that the bit form a few years ago, I wanted every time it makes a new image here that it prints out a print and it falls to the floor, and at the end of the day there are 10,000 prints, but of course it was too crazy. So my last work then, where I used the diagonal path, is that I choose two diagonal paths, but each path, you see here the black line is the path. But this black line has an incredible width. So the white, what you see is a thick line. And this thick line creates a form. I started also here making these prints. And then I animated it. I did it also with almost white on white. And then when I animated, you see these two forms fighting each other by creating these forms. It's all these machines I'm showing you here, they are never repeat. It's endless. And whatever you see right now, I never saw, nobody saw before, and will never come back. So what I would like to say is that I came to this kind of work, but if I go back to the early 70s, it was a very different time. My first drawings, when I showed them, people got aggressive, people got absolutely mad, and I got raw eggs thrown at me when I showed slides, because people could not understand that a computer could help an artist to do work. They called me a fascist, and I don't know what, I use military instruments to create, destroy art, and whatever you want. And no gallery, nobody wanted to show it. Everybody was afraid. It was almost like pornography. But I never cared a damn because I knew what I was doing and I liked it, what I do. And people always said, but is it art? Is it art? I said, why should I care if it's art? It's what I do. So I was always above the water. And I was never in any trouble when I started doing my work. And slowly, I had a gallery in Paris. He was suddenly interested in showing. And then the museum, like you mentioned, the museum came, made a show. And then slowly things got integrated. But yet, no art journal, art critic would ever talk about it. Whenever the word computer appeared, out of the magazine. And it went on. And I mean, I had in September a show at Bitforms. Even nowadays, there's a resentment against this kind of work. And it's very interesting because why get people so nervous about this? It doesn't hurt anybody. Why does logic, people don't want to have logic in art somehow. And but I'm sure that slowly all this will disappear. In a few years, nobody cares a damn how it, because I don't really care how it was made. If it's good, you see, my work is not a presentation of mathematical fanciness or something. I even would like to hide the math if I could, but I can't, because otherwise I can't do it. So what I want to do is the invention out of my algorithms, what comes out visually. That's what I want to show. And if what I'm showing is so strong in itself that you can forget about how it was made, then I succeeded. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Digital Art Jam. In 1968, he co-founded Art Age Informatique Seminar in Vincennes University in Paris. There he discovered Professor Max Benz's writing on information aesthetics from the early 1960s. These texts radically changed Manfred's thinking about creativity, and within a few years, his art transformed from abstract expressionism to computer-generated algorithmic geometry. Encouraged by the computer music composer Pierre Barbeau, whom he met in 1967, Manfred programmed his first computer drawings in 1969. His first major museum exhibition took place in 1971 at Musée d'Art Moderne de la Ville de Paris. Excuse me, that's wrong. It has since become known historically as the first solo show in a museum of works entirely calculated and drawn by a digital rather than analog computer. During that show, Manfred demonstrated the drawing of his computer-generated imagery using a Benson flatbed plotter for the first time in public. Since 1973, Manfred's pieces have been based on logical structure of cubes and hypercubes, including lines, planes, and relationships among them. The rules of geometry, logic, and mathematics are fundamental to the artist-authored algorithms that generate his artwork. Manfred's work is collected by many renowned museums, just to name a few: the Centre Pompidou in Paris, Joseph Albert's Museum Beaux-Arts, Victoria and Albert Museum London, Ludwig Museum Cologne, and the list continues to Amsterdam, Stuttgart, Berlin, Montreal, and New York. Some of these museums have also hosted his solo exhibition and retrospectives of his work. Manfred is a recipient of the Golden Nika from Ars Electronica, the Camille Grazer Prize Zurich, Develop Digital Art Award, the New York Foundation for the Arts Fellowship. Please welcome Manfred Mohr.
I'd like to thank NYIT and you, Patty, to make this evening possible and inviting me to that. I still have to go out of this. So I'm going to go back in my own history of how I became a digital artist, somebody who programs, writes algorithms. Because when I went to art school in the late 50s, the art of the day was abstract expressionism. And that's a very vital art, which was not very, in this sense, geometric or even intellectual, if you want. But I was very comfortable with this kind of art. And I can say that was my background. But I also have another background, which is music. I was an active jazz musician at that time. So everything is, whatever I do since these days, it always has a reference to music, in the sense that I always compare things, how they would sound. And all my work, I think, is like visual music. So since I have only a limited time and very many photos, I will go very fast through these photos. So what happened in 1960, I was painting things like this. And it was writing and musical expressions. But I started reading books by a German philosopher, Max Benzer, who was also an art critic. And he wrote about, or he argued that art should be rational. And that was exactly the contrary of what I was doing. And it wouldn't get out of my head. What is rationality in art? What is rational? And for years I tried to work it out, and of course slowly, like little geometry things came in my paintings, and I thought that might be rational, but of course it wasn't rational. And the geometry took over more and more, and still I thought maybe that's rational, but it wasn't rational. It was, the construction was rational, but not the content. Because at that time, I sort of cut from black paper forms and moved them around on white canvas and made sort of compositions, but the content wasn't logical. So what should I do? How could I get rational? And that moment, I met a musician in Paris, Mr. Pierre Barbeau, who wrote computer music. That's something at that time. So he gave a public lecture, and during that lecture, I suddenly understood what I have to do. I do not have to create a form and make a composition and this and that. I have to find, before I do make a form, a logic how to create the form and how the form will move around in the space. And that's when I understood I have to write programs. But in 1965, 66, you couldn't learn programming anywhere. There were maybe a handful of books in the world. So I had to start learning programming. Once I achieved that, I still didn't have a computer. At that time, a computer was a room like this here, full of loud machines and air conditioned, and nobody would have this at home. So how do I get to that? So everything was a problem at that time. So one night, again, a lucky strike, I saw in the news, and I lived in Paris at that time, I saw a program how the French meteorology just got a machine, which is called a plotter, which draws the weather map. So suddenly I said, Jesus, that's what I need. Mm-hmm. So I run there and I asked, of course, it didn't work out so fast. But eventually, to make the short, I mean, a short story, that I finally got access to this incredible computer room and the plotter, which was, at that time, I mean, I was the heaviest person in the world, because I think no artist in the world had such access to such technology at that time. And so I worked for the next 11 years every night and writing programs and plotting. And of course the first program I wrote was a random number generator. because at that time even these machines didn't have that. So the first thing I did was a book with random numbers, and then I constructed a sculpture with random numbers, and I started building up a program first with horizontal and vertical lines, probabilities of width and so forth, and it got more and more complicated, but always in reference to the music. So I go very fast through these things, because if I start explaining, it will take 2 hours. So I wrote all these programs and algorithms, and at one point I had exactly the same idea again. Of course it's logical, but there should be something more globally to the whole thing. I should sort of like invent a graphic music instrument, like in music, play a saxophone or whatever. So I thought and I came to the conclusion that the structure of a cube could be my instrument. Because I can play with the lines of the cube, taking them away and so forth. And that turned out very interesting. First, I studied the cube by taking lines away to see what forms they create, and this is what I took away. And then I made a very serious study of taking one line away, two lines away, three lines away, and calculated all the combinatorial possibilities. And I got completely out of my mind what kind of language I suddenly developed here. So I started with these elements to like adding, subtracting, taking logical instructions. Like here is adding up becomes a sign and so forth. So I did all this kind of operations with a cube, and then I looked into statistical distributions, like letting it slowly disappear or concentrate in the center. And I tried a movie at the time, but it was too early. This is a 2-minute movie, and it took me like 6 months to do it. Mm-hmm. So I gave up for that moment. But nowadays, this is a joke, because you can do it at home in your laptop. But at that time, it was a real big problem. So the next step was that I cut the cube in the middle. So I had two parts of the cube to turn. So I started disturbing the symmetry. That was one of my first inventions, in the sense that what I want to do is create a sign. I call them etragraphic. That means a graphic being, which has a structure, which was the cube. But I want to make a certain ambiguity, breaking symmetry, and creating like this new signs. So I did, he just showed the same painting. I went on, like I took the cube and from this moment on, everything is sort of based on, when you look at a cube from the front, you only see a square. So this square became sort of my inside operation and my outside operation of the cube. So here I only showed what I see inside of the square, and cut off the rest. I made all sorts of paintings. And then I started cutting the whole thing in four parts. So the symmetry got even more disturbed, and the sign became more and more interesting. So I built the structures, and I wrote a program of a sort of like a biological growth of cubes, which can grow on each other, and I built them as structures. And then I thought, maybe if I would go one dimensions higher, the fourth dimensional structure is nothing else than 8 cubes intermingled. So I would have an 8-fold vocabulary, and that's what I did. So I looked at the structure of the hypercube. This is a graph, you know. And I mean, you don't see it, but I took the graph apart and showed all these diagonal paths. What a diagonal is, everybody knows, but a diagonal path is a diagonal which, if you take a square, a diagonal, that's like everybody knows. But if you go on the side, each dimension once, that's a diagonal path. So you have a diagonal and a diagonal path in every object. So I built this in wood, which is, these are the diagonal paths. Here I show them how many times they can pass through the same state. And then I cut them in parts, like there are 24 lines, so no, there are 8 in each one. So if you add them up, you get the complete graph of the hypercube. So I made paintings out of that, or I ordered them in a magic square to build this kind of things. And then I left it as a, like I did in the cube before, I turned the cube to zero and looked what I see inside the square. And I took the whole hypercube apart of the 8 cubes and placed them next to each other to study what's in each one. And then once I understood that, I moved them back together and I created sort of like a shaped canvas because I cut out everything was outside the square. And I made this kind of paintings, which are, depending on the rotation of the cube, it changes the form and the content and the... And then I had my first retrospective in the Hub Museum in Germany, in Ludwigshafen, where for the first time saw my old work and my new work together, and I really couldn't believe that it would fit together because they had nothing to do with each other, but it worked out fine. I went even one more dimension higher, where I only show one line from each dimension, and I made this series of a constellation, like here the 10 drawings is the same drawing every time. It's like in three dimension, I can look at somebody from the front, from the side, or from the top, and I have three images. I see a face, an ear, and hair. Yeah. And in five dimensions, we have 10 such views. So this is the same constellation seen just from different views. And then I went even one more dimension higher. You see, it's not the mystical part of the dimension I'm interested in, or whatever, the impossibility of understanding the dimensions. It's the structure, which is so interesting and complex, and it gives you more and more possibilities to operate with it. So I studied here in a hypercube, in a six-dimensional hypercube, that, like I just said, the diagonal paths. That means a diagonal going through each dimension once. And I developed this incredible minimalist drawings, which is just going from one point to another in the structure. Here I cut it out with a laser in metal. It's very big. And again, this is one line seen from here, 15 different point of views. So it's an incredible poetic expression, this thing. Here's in a museum, in a show. And then I tried to put them together as a group of diagonal paths and cut them with a laser out of metal. And I made all sorts of structures. I painted these things on canvas. I did connect all the, every time that the diagonal paths would change the dimension, I connect them with thin lines. And I got to some drawings which are fantastically interesting, but I could not explain to anybody that this is complicated. Even though the content is very complicated, but with five lines, what should I say? So I was sort of standing against the wall. How could I communicate to anybody that this is complicated? So I decided at one point, here I also tried to make the outside lines connecting to the surface. So I built the shaped canvas out of, it built itself, the shaped canvas, so to speak. or I made them bending in metal. Then I thought, okay, if I can't explain the complexity, maybe if I would fill in like random numbers, random colors into these spaces which I create on the left, and then look what it does. And what I did here, I had to understand what I'm doing. So I animated this to unfold it into the sixth dimension. Because I after that, I can't understand it either anymore. But I know what I'm doing. So once I got into these things, I suddenly saw that using random colors, I mean, this is not based on any color theory, the colors should only be there as distinction. And the more different they are, the more they show the spatial relationship. So I did the... So I made paintings. I mean, paintings, I call them paintings, they are digital prints. This, by the way, was shown in your salon one day. And then I also animated this thing too. I made series and shows. And then I animated this thing. So now suddenly, if you contemplate on the thing, you feel the complexity of the structure, even though nobody can understand, including me. But that's not the point, the understanding. It's a visual result I'm playing with. And that shows me that the content is incredibly rich. And these colors, they're randomly chosen, and they disappear and appear and while this whole thing is rotating in six dimensions. I think I go always back to that. So I tried it in 11 dimensions. So an 11th dimensional hypercube has like 42,000 cubes or whatever. This is, of course, a structure which is impossible to even think about. But one can make a choice and use certain cubes from it. And I let the computer paint the surfaces of these cubes. I chose black and white. I mean, leave it white and make it black. And then I rotate them in 11th dimension. And I got these fantastic images. Let me see. And I built them machines to show. And when you see it turning, it's the same thing that you cannot understand what's going on, but there is an incredible form invention, which is exactly what I was looking for. Always the reference to my music, you know, to the visual music, which is really, it's almost chaotic free jazz what's happening here. And then I tried another thing with diagonal paths. I chose a certain amount of diagonal paths and let the computer color them, and also let the computer choose the width of the lines. So I created these compositions. I mean, they created themselves. And also, again, I animated this thing. But here I built two screens, here I show them flat next to each other. On the right side, the element moves, and every 10 seconds, it changes all the colors and all the lines. And the last image, before it changes, it throws on the left side. So when you look at these two screens, you see on the right side the evolution of a sign, but you can't catch it. Whereas on the left side, you get like a slideshow. You can contemplate for a while the sign. And originally, when I showed that bit form a few years ago, I wanted every time it makes a new image here that it prints out a print and it falls to the floor, and at the end of the day there are 10,000 prints, but of course it was too crazy. So My last work then, where I use the diagonal path, is that I choose two diagonal paths, but each path, you see here the black line is the path, but this black line has an incredible width. So the white, what you see is a thick line, and this thick line creates a form. I started also here making these prints, and then I animated it. I did it also with almost white on white. And then when I animated, you see these two forms fighting each other by creating these forms. It's all these machines I'm showing you here, they are never repeat. It's endless, and whatever you see right now, I never saw, nobody saw before, and will never come back. So what I would like to say is that I came to this kind of work, but if I go back to the early 70s, it was a very different time. My first drawings, when I showed them, people got aggressive, people got absolutely mad, and I got raw eggs thrown at me when I showed slides, because people could not understand that a computer could help an artist to do work. They called me a fascist, and I don't know what, I use military instruments to create, destroy art, and whatever you want. And no gallery, nobody wanted to show it. Everybody was afraid. It was almost like pornography. But I never cared a damn, because I knew what I was doing, and I liked it, what I do. And people always said, but is it art? Is it art? I said, why should I care? If it's art, it's what I do. So I was always above the water. And I was never in any trouble when I started doing my work. And slowly, had a gallery in Paris, he was suddenly interested in showing, and then the museum, like you mentioned, the museum came, made a show, and then slowly things got integrated, but yet no art journal or art critic would ever talk about it. Whenever the word computer appeared, out of the magazine. And it went on, and I mean, I had in September a show at Bitforms. Even nowadays, there's a resentment against this kind of work. And it's very interesting, because why get people so nervous about this? It doesn't hurt anybody. why does logic, people don't want to have logic in art somehow. But I'm sure that slowly all this will disappear. In a few years, nobody cares a damn how it, because I don't really care how it was made. If it's good, you see, my work is not a presentation of mathematical fanciness or something. I even would like to hide the math if I could, but I can't, because otherwise I can't do it. So what I want to do is the invention out of my algorithms, what comes out visually. That's what I want to show. And if what I'm showing is so strong in itself that you can forget about how it was made, then I succeeded. Mm-hmm. Thank you.